offering so forth. We're not passing a plate or anything along that line, but we have set an offering plate on the table back there in the back if you want to put your offering in that for today. Always, we have a number of people that are mailing them to us. You can even just come by and drop it through the mail slot. I'm here every morning. You can just pick it up at that time. We have some folks who are just taking it directly to Bonita. But wanted to remind everybody of that. And to thank you for your faithfulness in with your tithes and your offerings. Bonita's thinking maybe we need not take meat at church as far as offering goes because there's been more coming in. So we're not going to do that. I remembered this week. Surprise, surprise, surprise. Last week we started a new series. And I'll be honest with you, I'm not real sure where this series is going to go. As I shared last week, where it came from was the middle of the night a few weeks ago. And just having that one word, rejoice, just not stop going through my mind. Going through tough times, as all of us are with this, but in ministry, having to learn a lot of new things, come up with a lot of new ideas, and being an old man, it's not easy. And so when I went to sleep, I was kind of depressed about things, just feeling the pressure of everything. And I woke up a couple of hours later and I couldn't get that word rejoice, rejoice. Again, I said rejoice out of my mind. Okay, Lord, what are you wanting here? So that is basically where this has come from. It's already gotten added on to from what I was originally thinking. But I introduced it this last week because life, especially now, it has a lot of distractions, a lot of things that are trying to pull us off of the main road, that twists and turns and ups and downs and so forth, and it just gets frustrating. And what I asked you last week was we started off with two questions. Has fear ever taken you for a ride? Has fear ever taken you for a ride? And the second question was, has worry and anxiety ever sat in the driver's seat of your life? And what I'm finding is, where I thought that I was alone in a lot of this, that I'm not. That all of us kind of struggle with this at times, some more than others. But all of us seem to struggle with this, that it's so easy for fear and worry and anxiety to seem to consume our life, take control of our life. Now, I know, we know, that we're not supposed to live in fear. We're not supposed to live with worry and anxiety. Don't we know that? I can't see your smiles. But we know that. We've been taught that. So why? Why do we seem to fall prey to that so easily? I mean, we look at 1 John 4. Perfect love drives out fear. 2 Corinthians 7. Paul and his crew are in Macedonia and they're having a tough time. They're struck with things. And he says, we were harassed at every turn. Conflicts from the outside, fears within. This is Paul that is saying this. Matthew 6, in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus goes into a little story there and he says, why are you worried about your life? The Father cares for you. You are more valuable than these birds or these grass. Why are you worried about your life? How can you add one moment to your life by worrying? Proverbs 5, an anxious heart weighs a man down. We know that feeling. When you start carrying that burden of that anxiousness, it just weighs you down. Philippians 4, here's a verse that we've been looking at the last a number of times, says, be anxious about nothing. 2 Corinthians 5, 7, walk by faith, not by sight. Hebrews 10, my righteous one, will live by faith. We are his righteous ones, made righteous through blood of Christ. And how are we to live? By faith, not by worry, not by fear, not by anxiety, but by faith. We know that. We are taught that. We believe that. But yet we fall prey to that fear, worry, and anxiety. That trio of emotions that God did not design in us. Remember in 1 Peter it says, cast all your cares upon him. Why? Because he cares about you. He loves you. How often will we do that? Now, this isn't groundbreaking news. I'm not saying anything new to you that I never thought of that before. It's not that at all. We know this. So why then do we let fear take us for a ride? Why do we let worry and anxiety sit in the driver's seat? We know better. And that's what makes it so frustrating, for me anyways, and I think for you. Because we know better, but yet we fall prey to that. So we then get frustrated. Satan wants nothing more than for us to live our life dwelling on fear. Because dwelling on fear then feeds down into worry. And the longer we sit there, that escalates then into anxiety. Last week I read you a little statement by Robert Dawson where he says fear is common to the human condition. And we would have to say yes to that. Fear just comes naturally to us. Why is that? Well, think about it. Where were we first introduced to fear in the scriptures? It's when Adam and Eve started all this mess with taking a bite out of that forbidden fruit. And what did they do? It opened their eyes. They knew they were naked, and they did what? They hid in fear. Remember when God came through the garden, he called, Adam, where are you? And Adam speaks, and God says, why are you hiding from me? Because we're in fear. That's where this all started. So, Satan is utilizing that tool. The problem here is that the more that we dwell on this fear, we open the door then for his cousins of worry and anxiety to come in some form or another. So last week we started this to address this subject of fear and how we can get a handle on the fear. If we can get a handle on fear, and because there is good fear, if we can get to where we don't let that be in our driver's seat of our life, then doesn't it make sense then we don't have to worry about the worry side of things or the anxiety if this is the way it goes? So we started digging into that last week, and we're going to dig more into it this week and next week. So let me ask you, where does fear that leads to worry, that leads to anxiety, where does that come from? And some of you say from the pit of hell. Well, that's not really the answer I'm looking for, even though that's the source of it and probably is Satan's greatest tool that he utilizes for us, on us. But seriously, what normally causes fear to swell up inside of us and start taking control? Doesn't it start when we start focusing on the junk that's going on around us? The junk from out there that's happening to us? The uncertain times that we can't control? That are just beyond our ability to have a handle on it? Those things that are out there. Not in here, but out there. Those things that are in the dark, under the bed, in the closet. I remember when, as I was preparing for this, I went back in memory to when we lived in Verona, New York, and we had a big, well, at that time it looked big, I don't know what size it really was, but I had a dad had given me a board game that was a baseball game that had a little bat, and it was a thing made out of wood. It was under my bed. And I remember one night waking up, and it sounded like the biggest rat in the world was chewing on my game down there. And fear, because, oh, this has got to be the biggest thing there ever was. I'm not stepping out. It's kind of like Bill Cosby's thing with snakes under the bed. Snakes, I'm sticking my tongue, don't you bite me. But it was kind of that. And when we caught what was underneath the bed, it was an itty bitty little old mouse. Nothing to fear, but my fear had swelled up, making it so enormous that it was groundbreaking in size. That's what fear can do to us. When we focus on unknown, what is out there? This isn't new to us, is it? Look at some Bible examples. The Hebrew people, why didn't they go into the promised land the first time they came? Because of the size of the walls of the city and the size of the people. We are like grasshoppers next to them. That was where their focus was at, and their fears swelled up. Elijah goes through this amazing, amazing demonstration of God's power on Mount Carmel, of fire coming down and consuming everything. And in just, 24 hours? We find him running to the wilderness and getting out in the wilderness and being so worn out that he wanted to die. Pray, just let me die. I'm the only one left. All because this Queen Jezebel had threatened him. His focus was on what? On being pursued, on that danger that was out there. We look at the Gideon. Why is he hiding, threshing wheat in a hole in the ground? Because of outside fears of the Midianites. What are they going to do? They're going to steal my grain. What are they going to do? So he's hiding in a hole. And when God makes it clear that he's with him, he still focuses on outside things. As if our tribe is the fewest of all of them. We can't do anything. And his fear swelled up inside of him. Again, great army of Israel on one side of this valley. Palestinians are on the other side. And the great army of Israel is cowering in fear because of one person, one giant of man, but one person. Because he's loud and he has these threatening words. And they're focused on that. And they cower themselves in fear and they forget the size of their God and the size of his promises. for them, to be with them. We see this with the disciples. The Sea of Galilee, Galilee. Twice we see them experience this, being out there and the storms come up. And they're focused on the storm and they are gripped with fear, Scripture says. And then Jesus comes walking on the water, which brought new fears. Because that just can't happen. That's not natural. Gripped them with new fear. And then Peter, remember, with Jesus' invitation, steps out of the boat and walks on the water to Jesus as long as his eyes are on Jesus. But what happened as soon as he took his eyes off of Jesus and placed them on the waves and the wind? He sank. And Jesus came to his rescue. The second time, Jesus is in the boat with them, the very boat with them. And the storm comes up, but Jesus is asleep. Remember how the disciples came to him and said, "Lord, Lord, we're going to drown." Some versions say, "Do you not care that we're going to perish?" Where's their focus? Out there on the things that are out there. And Scripture says that Jesus got up and he rebuked the wind. And calm came. Peace was with them. The source of peace was with them the whole time. And they knew that. But they forgot it when their focus was on what was out there. Going back to the scripture that I brought to you earlier with Paul in 2 Corinthians 5:7. He and his crew were at Macedonia on one of the mission trips, and things aren't going well. People aren't cooperating or whatever. And remember what I read to you. This body of ours has had no rest. Why? We were harassed at every turn. Who's doing the harassing out there? Those. Conflicts on the outside. Fears within. Conflicts on the outside, fears within. Now remember, this is Paul. But then he continues with what probably is the most life-altering two words that we can ever hear when fear is trying to sit in our driver's seat. Says, "But God. But God, who comforts the downcast, comforted us." But God stepped in and brought calm, brought peace in the chaos. There's so many examples of fear coming on and overwhelming biblical characters simply because their focus was on the things that were out there, that were out in the around us, around them. But then God steps in and they experience that "but God" moment of peace. Still within what they were fearing before. Peace in the midst of their fears, in the midst of the storms, the conflicts. Peace in the midst of the circumstances and situations that they found themselves facing. Right now in our country, in our world, there's so many people struggling with fear. And that leads them to being stressed out with worry, kind of under the thumb of anxiety. And what that does is it steals their hope. people are all uptight simply because of the possibilities of things they might experience. Uncertainty of what's going to happen. Now, their normal life has been interrupted, which, by the way, might not be bad. Just they lost control. Look, all of us have been there. All of us have experienced this before. Maybe some of you right now. We've all had tough situations before. All of us have had times when things were out of our control. When we weren't certain of what tomorrow was going to hold. When our lives were turned upside down. Not knowing when it was going to get turned right side up again. And we worry. Because the fear in us swells up. And it builds into anxiety that it can be just life crushing. How did we make it through that in the past? How did we get through that in the past? What happened that turned our focus onto Jesus rather than our circumstances or situations we were in? Remember that? How did he meet us? He met us with joy and met us with peace. That's what he said he came to give us. When we looked at these scriptures last week, came to give us his peace. His peace in the middle of the trouble that we're facing. Came to give us his joy. In the middle of everything that we are going through, his joy. Not as the world gives, he says, but my peace, my joy. Life is going to have its twists and turns. It's going to have its ups and downs. We all know that. There will be troubles and tribulation, heartaches. Jesus tells us that. There will be times we feel hurt. All of us know this. We have all experienced it. And as long as we keep our focus on those troubles, those tribulations, those heartaches, all those fears will be fed. And we'll grow gray hair. I didn't say that. I mean, we'll get worried. And that'll lead us into anxiousness that dominates our life. But Jesus tells us we don't have to go there. His peace carries us through all of those twists and turns and all those ups and downs of life. All those things we're going to experience just simply because we live in a fallen world. It's that peace that makes us think, where did that come from? I'm reminded. I'm trying to make it through this. I'm reminded of that evening when the doctor told Matt and Donna and me that they couldn't save Jenna. I remember that crushing that I felt, the knees buckled and going down to the floor. And just all of the thoughts that just... And all of a sudden realizing that I'm going to have to go out in the waiting room, I'm going to have to tell the rest of the family that Jim has passed away. How can I do that? I'm crushed. And all of a sudden, and I can't explain it, all of a sudden there was a peace that came over me, a calmness that gave me the strength to stand up and to go out and tell the rest of the family. I can't explain it. It was a strength that didn't come from me. It was a strength that didn't come from any source that I had. It only came from our loving Father that was there in that moment, knowing exactly what I needed to be able to give that to the Father. Peace beyond our understanding. Where did that come from? As Christ followers, our lives are supposed to model this. The world is supposed to see our lives in this way. Peace, no matter what else is going on in our life. And that's what brings glory to the Father, because it comes only from Him. It's nothing we can swell up inside of ourselves. So that's what the world's supposed to see in us. So the question has to be asked, is that what the world sees in me, in you, in us, as a Seventh-day Baptist Church at Texarkana? We started looking at Philippians 4 last week. We're going to continue there this week and next week, because there's three keys that are here in Philippians 4 for helping us to put a handle on that fear, so that worry and anxiety doesn't even get introduced to us. This week, we're just going to be looking at the first one. The first key is how we pray. It's Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Do not be anxious or worried about anything. Remember where that anxiousness, that worriedness comes from. It comes from our fear, our focus on things out there. Do not be anxious about anything. But in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Paul's point here is not that we are supposed to live life detached from reality, but God calls us to live our lives attached to, focused on His ultimate reality. To live as though God is in control, knowing that God is our provider, that God is sovereign over all things. To live a life by taking our concerns to Him, and having God rule over those concerns, and not letting our fears escalate then into worry, into anxiousness. Instead of placing our focus on our fears, Paul is telling us through prayer to put our focus on our Heavenly Father. That is the source of being able to take care of them. Live lives that are prayer-filled. But in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. The things that we could choose to worry about, we are to take them to God in prayer. I ran into a little ditty that I wrote down a while back, saving it for a rainy day. And this is it. When you worry, you own it. When you pray, God owns it. When you worry, you own it. Whatever it is. When you pray, God owns it. We make our requests known by prayer. But we're to do it with thanksgiving. This attitude of gratitude reminds us that God is, can be and should be and is always trustworthy. It reminds us that of what he's done in the past, what he's maybe doing even in the present, that is exactly what he will do in the future, because he is sovereign over all situations. There will come a day, yes, when we will have peace from our troubles. But until that time comes, we have peace through our troubles. The key is that's an unhealthy fear or anxiety. It's not less problems. The key is more trust on our part of our Heavenly Father and his ability to deal with the problems we're having. So there's a promise here in the scripture too. What is the promise? It's the protection of the peace of God. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Transcends all understanding. What does that mean? This is the peace that comes when there are no answers. It's the peace that comes when there's no logical reason why. Peace that comes when you don't know how it came. Like in that emergency room that night. This is the peace. This is a supernatural peace that can only come from our Heavenly Father, from God. What does that do? It will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This Greek picture that is painted here with this phrase is the Roman soldiers standing guard around you. God's peace is that way. It acts like a soldier that's guarding over your heart, over your mind, blocking or you're impeding anxious, worried thoughts from having a clear shot at you. I don't know if you ever ran into that, into a situation where you've been driving down the road and up ahead you can see that the police have a barricade across the road and they're stopping all the traffic for whatever reason. Maybe they're looking for a criminal. Maybe they're just checking to see if you've been naughty and under the influence or whatever. Whatever the case, that barrier is there to impede whatever is going on the other side, or you from getting to the other side, whatever needs to be put to the side. And this is how God's peace works. Excuse me. When we go to him with thankful prayer, many of the things that could worry us, that could spin us out of control with anxiety, they get pulled to the side and stopped because we are guarded by Christ Jesus. So then you have a choice. You can focus on all the twists and the turns, all the distracting signs that are around you, or you can focus on the smooth road of peace. Remember, the scriptures tell us that the right road is a narrow road, but it's straight. And Jesus tells his disciples that the Spirit is with us. And if we start veering to the left or veering to the right, if we start paying attention to that worldly road sign or this worldly road sign. The Holy Spirit taps us on the shoulder and brings us back to the straight and narrow road, going through all the troubles and the things of life. So how we pray is the first key to getting a handle on our fear, putting it to the side and walking in peace on that straight road, driving on the smooth road of life through the different situations that we face, different circumstances that we experience. Next week, we will continue with the next two keys. It's how we think and how we live. But until next Sabbath, I've got a challenge for you. Open yourselves to the Holy Spirit. Examine yourselves. What are you fearing? Is fear dominating your life? What is it that you are fearful of? I mean, take that to your Father in prayer. Hand it over to Him. I can't do that for you. No one else can do that for you. You do that on your own. But until next Sabbath, this is my reminder to you. Present your requests to God. And let the peace of God, even though you don't understand it, let His peace flood over you. Let His peace guard your heart. Guard your mind. Because it's going to be done by the power of Christ Jesus, your Lord and Savior. And if you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior and you're thinking this doesn't make sense, all of this, probably for you, and I understand it, it probably doesn't make sense. But I know from experience what a precious moment it is to be able to stand in God's presence, His holy presence, and know that He not just listens, but cares about what is going on in my life, in your life. Put somebody up that's a Christian friend of yours. Talk to them. I know that'll bring a huge smile on them. Because that's what Christ followers do. They want to introduce that peace to you. And maybe you know Christ, but you're getting consumed with the worries and the fears that are all around you. Take this moment just to kneel down. Say, Father, forgive me, I haven't trusted you with this. And just hand that over to Him. And let His peace flood over you. It does that because of His precious gift of Jesus Christ. They carried that on the cross, but rose again out of the tomb to show us and to give us new life, newness to life. He's calling you to come to Him. Talk to Him. And listen to Him talk to you. Father, we thank You for Your word, for Your promises, and for this precious gift that comes to us because of Jesus, comes to us through Jesus, of His gift. Peace that doesn't make any sense down here on this earth. And His joy. Father, I pray that as we accept that and this precious gift, that Father, our lives would be radically changed, where fears would not dominate us anymore, wouldn't have the opportunity to escalate into worry and then develop into a life-crushing anxiety. Father, to open ourselves up to you and let you choose to let you guard our hearts and our minds by the power that is in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father. Amen. For the last hymn, we're going to be singing 439, Sweet Hour of Prayer. 439. Please stand. Over these, your children. Keep them safe. Open their minds to your spirit that lives and dwells within them. Father, let them know your presence is there and guide them. Keep them safe and flood over their lives with your presence.